Hi, everybody. I just made this great big welcome, and the producer, who has no voice, and it's so funny, if she's challenged too much, you will hear her come on, and she's going to sound like this because she has no voice. But nevertheless, she did not have me on the switchboard. You see how she tried to set me up for failure? Welcome, everybody. This is Jazzy Jones, Miss of the Bare Truth, Love, Life, Sex, and Flowers 2020. It's been such a long time since we have actually been on with this particular show because we've been doing a lot of special editions with our tea time, our new off-the-market segment, and several other special edition correspondences that we've had for shows. But today is a special day because it's Tuesday, which is usually my day to bring you the bare truth. We talk about things that a lot of people don't have the nerve to talk about. But anyway, let me get a few things out of the way. We have been on air for 7 years. Yay! Whew. Crowd goes crazy. Audience goes crazy. Yeah! No, I'm just kidding. Boom. Anyway, we have had the opportunity of being on air for 7 years, and that is all because of you, our listening audience all over the world. You are the reason why we can still say that we have an online radio network bringing you conversations, bringing you entertainment, bringing you sports, bringing you music, bringing you political conversations and social changes conversations. It's all because of you that we're still here. Having said that, if you would like to be part of our radio network as an advertisement or talking about your business or your brand, please contact us at 706. Listen to the producer. Can you stop messing up the switchboard? Let me do that again. If you would like to be a part of this comedy show, please call us at 706-363-3895. We will be so happy to have you a part of our network and the conversations that we have here. I want to be able to bring you wonderful coverage of your business, your idea, your brand. Shoot your commercial. We'll come on and do a live right on the spot to tell people all about who you are and what you want us to say for you. We will be your voice when you are so quiet. So funny, we have so many people who actually use our services that are saying, no, we don't want to say anything. You guys say it all for us. And so we're here to do that very gladly. So once again, if you want to be a part of that, a part of our coverage, please contact 706-363-3895. We're going to be right back because we have a very special guest that will be coming on right after we salute the people who have used our services. We'll be right back.
You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network. You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network.
Insurance Associates Atlanta, formerly Mathis Insurance Services, is an independent agency offering personal, commercial, life, and health insurance products to meet the needs of your business and your family. We specialize in helping you protect all of your assets, whether you're purchasing insurance for the first time or searching for better products at a better price. Feel free to contact us at 770-483-0310. We're conveniently located at 1030 Remington Drive in Conyers, Georgia. Visit us online at insurance-iaa.com.
Recent auto accident, back pain, neck pain, stress, headache? Ewing Chiropractic can help. Here at Ewing Chiropractic, our office utilizes an approach of pain relief measures for the treatment of auto accidents, slip and fall, sport, and on-the-job injuries, as well as acute and chronic pain. We can be reached at 678-586-3592 and located at 5459 North Henry Boulevard, TC in Stockbridge, Georgia. Healing the injured one spine at a time, we can be reached at ewingchiropractic.com.
All right, we are back. Thank you so much for those that help keep this network alive, doing business with us. Once again, we are 7 years old, and I don't know if you guys saw the release that we had this last week, but Black Enterprise, y'all, Black Enterprise actually featured us, as well as Black News featured us and our accomplishments. And so we don't take that lightly. We're not walking around with the big heads, but we do want to salute them for saluting us. It takes a lot to even keep a small of a network as we have together, and so we want to always say thank you to those that are really just kind of putting us out there, and so we take pride in that. But nevertheless, you can see that on loudmouthradio.com. You can see that, and on our social media, we're on Facebook, we're on Instagram, and we're on the tweet. Okay, that would be Twitter. So without further ado, I am so excited to have our guest, I was about to say host, have our guest back in the studio. Tracy Wilson of the TNT Wilson Foundation is joining us again after, I believe she was our first or second year, she was actually on a radio network, which, you know what, it's so nice when we are able to bring guests back who have been with us and supported us and bringing us information and news that you, the audience, want to hear, that you ask for, and actually that you learn from. So I am so proud to have Tracy Wilson back with us, and we're going to bring her on air because we're ready for her. Tracy, are you with us? Let's see. Can y'all hear the producer whispering in the back? Okay, so she's telling me to introduce Tracy first. See, this is why you have to have the producer doing stuff, but when she loses her voice, I'm just, oh, that's not what I do. Okay, Tracy, hang on 1 second. I know you're standing here with your hands up in the air like, I'm here. But let me tell the people who you are. So we have, as I stated, Tracy Wilson, which is the founder and the CEO of TNT Wilson Foundation, which we recently have had a name change, because it used to be the Terrell Wilson Foundation, but now it's called the TNT Wilson Foundation. The organization originally began as the Terrell Wilson Foundation in memory of Tracy's youngest son, Terrell Wilson, who died at the age of 14 from aorta dissection. Did I say that right? I think I said that right. Tracy would later change the name of the organization due to the tragic loss of her oldest son, Tyquan, in April of 2019. Tyquan battled severe depression and was diagnosed with bipolar schizophrenia. According to the latest bipolar statistics quoted by the Depression and Bipolar Support Alliance, bipolar disorder affects approximately 5.7 million adult Americans and about 2.6% of the U.S. population age 18 and older every year. Tyquan was only 27. Now Tracy is determined to create a legacy as the voice that her sons no longer have. Her mission will now be to address matters of the heart and mind as a centerpiece of the organization. And with that, we will now welcome my sister, my friend, Tracy Wilson.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, sis. It's been such a long time.
No, I know. But you're doing great, and I'm so happy about your accomplishment. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you so much. See, I'm over here doing host and producer, and producers in the back with all of her non-speaking voice. I'm so excited. I get to say things and do things that she is over here giving me the crooked eye about.
Oh, that's what happens when your voice is silent. can't
think that. Oh, my God. And you know she's having a fit because the name of our network is Loudmouth, because she's a loudmouth and she loves to talk. She loves to have conversations. So this is really rough for her, but definitely when she has a format and a way that she's doing things, she hates that she's not speaking, but she is sending me loving kisses and hugs and all of that kind of stuff with sign language.
Aw, loves and kisses back.
So, Tracy, we wanted to definitely bring you back on, and we were so happy when you told us about things that you have coming up and just your ability to want to give us an exclusive of what has taken place in your life with your son. Recently, we definitely know the story of Terrell, though those of you that have not heard it, we definitely want her to be able to reiterate the things that we talked about years ago. But truly, we want to talk about what has happened to your life and how has it impacted you and what you want to do with tragedy. And I'm a firm believer that, you know, we do have a lot of things that are painful and we have a lot of ashes in life. And so out of the ashes, we definitely have found that parable to be true, that we can find beauty. And so we want you to tell your pain, but we want to also hear what beauty is coming out of that. So please share with our audience, wide and near, this story.
Okay. Well, let me breathe. I always say that before I talk about either one of my children. I just say breathe, Tracy, you know.
Yeah.
So
yes.
In 2018, Tyquan came to live with me because I had major surgery. I'm going to give you the story as much as I can. He came to live with me because I had a major surgery. And, you know, we have gotten so close since Terrell's passing in 2007. He was my oldest child, so he was with me the longest. And then enters 2019, it starts off okay, you know, and I noticed some changes in his behavior. But as a mom, you know, he's grown, so you just kind of step back and allow him to be the grown man that he's becoming. As everybody knows, well, most people know, you know, and Sonny knows, that I'm a huge Prince fan. So in the midst of all of this going on, I had planned, I had raised $6,000 for this little boy with brain cancer to go to Minnesota last year, April. And his name is Cater. He has stage 2 brain cancer. So that was what my focus on, just trying to get him and his family to Minnesota back in April. And in the midst of doing this, my son was tragically hit by a train April 16th, 2019. Prior to that, about 2 weeks before he passed away, he had a breakdown. He had a nervous breakdown, and he entered the hospital, and they put him in a mental institution in Athens, Georgia, and they kept him in there for about 4 days. They released him. They put him in the hospital April 8th. They released him April 12th, and then April 16th, he passed away. He was walking to work. Normally, he walks to work. He got that honesty from me. He likes to walk. And that they released him, not making sure that the medication was working, that it was like in his system enough where he could return to it. So he was on 3 different types of antidepressants plus high blood pressure medicine. And all this together, it just didn't, you know, it didn't gel with him. Yeah,
right.
It didn't mesh with him at all. And now he had passed away 24 hours before I had even knew, because I saw him that Monday and we talked for a minute, you know, we laughed, and, you know, he said some funny things to me that Monday night. And I went to work that Tuesday, and, you know, I came home, and he still wasn't home. I hadn't seen him. You know, I hadn't heard from him, but that was his normal. When he worked, he would stay at his friend's house, you know, because he had an early day the next day. And I remember texting him that Tuesday night and asking him if he had his keys. And he didn't respond. I was about 8:30 Tuesday night. Didn't respond, and I didn't worry. But that night, Jazzy, I had a dream that I was in Minnesota, and my sister told me to come home because Tyquan was hurt. And as I touched ground in Atlanta, Tyquan had passed away. That was a dream. So it was like God showing me what had already happened, but it wasn't aware yet. So I get up, and I go to work, I do my normal. And my motherly instinct kicks in because I text him again and he doesn't respond. And that's not like him not to respond to none of my text messages.
Exactly.
So I go to work and I say, I got to go. I got to go find my son. This is not like my son not to contact me. And knowing that he was still on the medication and knowing the little things that had just happened the week before. So I come home and I look for him everywhere. I can't find him. And I finally call the cops. And then they put me on hold because by now it's already been 24 hours. He didn't have any information with my name on it as to the next of kin. So I'm in a panic, and the sheriff from where I live at in Statham comes to my house. And, well, he's talking to them on the phone as they're talking to me. And he says, I know her. She's the manager at the Dollar General up the street. So they go to the store looking for me, but I'm not there because I got transferred. And then he comes to my house. And that's when he tells me that was hit by. So I go,
wow.
I go,
no. Okay, continue.
And I'm like, here we go again. So what happens in that instinct is I had just got to the place of acceptance with Terrell. So it's 12 years now. So some time has passed. So I've gotten through the five stages of grief, and I've gotten to acceptance with Terrell not being here. I created this new life for me and Tyquan. Even though Tyquan was grown, we still had to create something without Terrell, and I did that. So here I am alone, and now I got to do it again by myself.
Right.
So it's a very different feeling, you know, for him to be diagnosed with bipolar schizophrenia. I didn't want to believe it because, you know, it's taboo in our communities. We don't talk about stuff like that. That's not true. That's
oh, my
not
God,
what
yes.
Not
no.
That's not
mm-mm. And we're going to pray about it. We're going to pray about it. That's it.
We're going to pray about it and keep it going.
Mm-hmm.
And I was oblivious to it. And then I went through the guilty stages of, like, okay, did I miss something? Was it something that he wasn't, you know, was I a bad mom? You know, so I went through all of that, you know, because in overall, I came down here to give my kids a better life. And then I felt like that I gave them life, but I also gave them death. That was my guilt. I don't know what that was about, but that I know that wasn't what happened. It was that God needed them more, and my pain has to become my purpose now. So the voice that they don't have, I have to use it.
Yes. Tracy, let me just say, let me do that.
Yeah.
Let me breathe with you, because, you know, I posted something to announce the show yesterday, and I said, you know, for a mother to bury one child, it's just like something you can't think about. You're like, wow, that's just too much. But for a mother to have to bury two is just, you can't wrap your mind around it. And so that's for us that have never had a loss or two, but to have you have to live through it is just like, wow. And for you to be able to speak about it is so amazing. I really want to say that publicly, because I say it to you privately, but I want to say it to you publicly that it is incredible for you to be able to dig deep, go within, and have the strength to come on this show or just period and talk about it. And so what's so wonderful about it is a few things. One, anytime we can talk through the pain means that we're in the healing process, which this is the name of the show, Loss, Love, in the healing conversation. Because in order for you to go past the point of pain, you have to have the pain come out. You know, you have to be able to get it from in the gut of the belly all the way out to the degree that we're able to then walk forward. So I commend you tremendously on that feat. And to have the voice now to say, okay, here are the issues that my sons went through. Now let me speak to the world, because it may be somebody that you need to help, but it's definitely there are laws that need to be in place, or better in place, for us to protect our children from the things that cause them harm. One of the things that I heard you say, and many of you know, that for years I went around with a group of women talking about specifically bipolar disorder. One of the young ladies who that were on the panel with us, she was diagnosed with bipolar schizophrenia. So she had the duality of the mental illness diagnosis, and she was almost killed for the very thing that you just said, by them mixing too many medications, caused an adverse effect on her, and she ended up being extremely aggressive, more so than she was even without the medication. And so not having the medical field, and then not having law enforcement understand the mental illness, she was treated so horribly and arrested and treated, you know, just in a way which nobody who's already ill and trying to understand what's going on in their mind should ever have to feel and go through. So have you been able to find out the actual information? I'm sorry, you may hear producer in the back blowing her nose with all of these allergies. So I apologize.
That's okay. I get it. We family, so I understand. The allergies are crazy. Well,
for me,
when Tyquan went to the hospital, they took him to the hospital because he had a breakdown of some sort. I wasn't home. I wasn't here. He was at work. And he told them, he said, in my head, told me to hurt myself. But my mother was home, and I didn't want her to find me. So when they're explaining this to me, I'm like, what voice is this? What are you talking about? First of all,
wow,
there is no voice. You know what I mean? Like, no, we're not going to
mm-hmm.
do that. But again,
no.
That's
right.
The ignorance. Child is not bipolar. My child doesn't have this, okay? So that was the first thing. The second thing was when he tried to leave the hospital, and of course they put him on the 1013, and the 1013 is basically when the state comes in and they do,
yes,
they have full custody of him, and they can do whatever they want to do with him. And they,
yes,
brought him to the mental hospital up here, and they let him out, and he gave me his paperwork, and I'm reading this stuff, but a lot of it,
mm-hmm,
I don't understand. I'm not a doctor, so I don't understand what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
So some of it I recognize, some of the behaviors that he had expressed and some of the depression that he was dealing with. And the day before Terrell passed away, him and Tyquan had a big argument. This is going back to 2007. And Tyquan,
mm-hmm,
said, I hope you die. I wish I was the only child, and I hope you die. And then the next day, Terrell passed away. So Tyquan carried that conversation with him for 12 years.
I can imagine.
Like, he never,
I can imagine,
that last conversation he had with his little brother. So, and then, you know, it's just a lot of different things happening. You know, he's at that age. My son was very good looking, all these girls. You know, it was a lot of stuff, a lot of things that was happening around him that was making him just, like, tired.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the real and raw truth how I feel as a mom. They didn't rule his death as suicide. They ruled it as an accident.
Mm-hmm.
There's a part of me that feels like he said, you know what, I'm done. You know what I mean? I'm
right,
over it. I'm tired of feeling like this. I'm going to put my headset on, and I'm just going to. But then there's a part of me, the child that I raised, the man that I was raising, feel like it was more of the medicine that altered his thinking. You know,
exactly.
Like it had him, because when he came home, I said, Tyquan, what are you looking at? And he said, Mom, it's the medicine. I can't do nothing. I can't move. I don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. So I was like, well, maybe we need to get it adjusted. And in my head, I was like, why didn't they keep him like a week or two just to make sure that he was okay?
Mm-hmm.
So now what I'm trying to do here in Georgia is get Tyquan's law passed. When our children are diagnosed with bipolar schizophrenia or bipolar or depression or any type of mental illness, that they get to stay in the hospital until their medicine, you know, just levels them out enough where they can function. So that's
right.
What I'm working on.
Right. You know what? It's so important. Again, commending you, and I can speak on so many different levels. We often have the conversation on an inbox or a text because everything doesn't always have to be public. But you know, I have many things that I don't share, but I do when it comes down to certain things that I feel like here is my life. Let it be an example so that somebody else can glean from, draw strength from, and use in some manner. So I always try to, you know, talk about those things. And, you know, you and I have shared, nobody will really understand the magnitude of burying their child until they bury a child. You cannot wrap your head around the immense pain that is involved to bury your child. And, you know, you and I have shared that story, but I even take it a step further with you and parents like you that have had years and years and years with their children to have to then allow those children and their spirit to go back to the Creator. It's so rough. It's so raw. It's so rare. And then to have to deal with the issues and the causes of those children transcending back is the job now, right? And so I've also dealt with mental illness, with bipolar disorder, and knowing what it feels like to not have the stability of mind, knowing what it feels like to have to be in a hospital, knowing what it feels like to be on so much medication that you cannot remember what day it is, you cannot remember what year it is. You want to commit suicide way more a lot of times on these medications than you ever wanted to do prior to being on medication, all in the name of healing you. In 2020 actually started in last year, 2019, where doctors were then coming out saying, you know what, we're not in the healing business. We do only want to make money. We are part of the pharmaceutical companies. You know, some print. And so, therefore, we're just going to give medicines because we make more money, but we're not really into the healing. So it's important, what you just said, is to find a way that laws have to be passed. This is why the vote is so important, because if we don't vote for the local people to hear us for things like this, our children, our families, ourselves, we're in danger of constantly being put in a position where we're not our whole self and we're not our best self. So what steps are you taking? Have you met with anybody in government? I know you've been given keys to cities and you've been given proclamations with the Terrell Wilson Foundation. You know, you're somewhat of a big deal when it comes down to your children. And it's a good thing because it's going to help so many other children. Have you now sent, you have found inner strength, and I know that's through a lot of prayer, a lot of meditation. Have you found people who are able to rally with you concerning this?
Well, the first thing I had to do for me, because self-care is important. First, I had to grieve. I had to go through that grief period of getting my own mental head together, because now, when I go to the cemetery, I have to see both of my children side by side. So mentally, it's horrible, but I'm their mom, so I have to make sure that their grades are okay. So mentally, I have to get my head together. So now that some time has passed, and the Jersey in me, the fighter in me, is ready to go to war for my kids. You know what I mean? So those contacts that I made with the Terrell Wilson Foundation, I'm making those contacts with those same contacts, but just in a different format. I'm working on a few things. It, a lot of people say, I got you, whatever you need, but you
come on now. Come on.
Show me what you can do. And, you know, mm-hmm. we're so big mm-hmm. in the community, and everybody says things like, you know, whatever you need, and then you come to them, and then you can never get a response, or you can never get a text back or email back, or not even a phone call.
Exactly.
And I'm like, well, then I'll be that one woman show for my kids.
You have to.
So
yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I do exactly
what you mean. Then nobody's going to ride harder for my kids than me. And that's the bottom
right.
line.
Right.
I'm in grief counseling, which is very difficult because not only does she want to talk about Tyquan, she wants to talk about Terrell too. And I'm like, I can't do both. You know, you got to pick one. Let's just deal with the recent. And then I work, and, you know, I just keep myself really busy. But there are times when the encourager needs encouraging. You know, I do a lot of people come to me and they say, how do you do it? How are you standing? You're the strongest woman I know. I mean, I would be out of my mind. And when I tell you that I'm doing this cold turkey, there's no medication. I'm not on any medication. I'm not on any antidepressants. I think the only thing in my system that I take is if when I have a cold, and that's NyQuil. You know, to do this, because I've met people who that lost a child, that has to take medication just to function. That has never been with both of my children, you know. So, and all I can say is that's God. That's God's grace.
Yes.
Like, you know, it's just God, and I get up every day, and I'm like, thank you, God. Okay, what we doing today? You know, that's just where I'm at. And even with Terrell, I never got angry with God. I never questioned God. I asked God, why? I mean, what now? Even now with Tyquan, still I say, well, what is this? You know, I just ask, okay, what am I supposed to be doing? What is this? No, what really is this? You know, and I'm supposed to turn this pain into my purpose. I said that in a message to you. So that's where I'm at. Like, I need to be there for another mother who can't get out of bed. You know, I need to be the voice of, in addition to the mental health, suicide awareness too, because that's part of it too. Because you're right.
Right.
They can't function on vacation. They think about those things, you know. So we want to advocate for all of that stuff. We do.
Right. Ooh, Tracy girl. I tell you, girl, let me tell you, we have often watched your journey, you know, with your son, and everybody will say, oh, well, you know, Tracy, it's been 2 years, it's been a year, it's been 12, it's been 10, it's been 20, whatever the year amount. Girl, you should have got over it by now, right? And once again, until you bury the child. You don't know the grieving process. But what I can say, 2 years prior to Tyquan passing, I started to see your strength. I started to see the healing, as you stated, that you had just kind of come to terms with Terrell. And you know, I was so proud of you. And then to, boom, have this hit. So it is. You know, everybody that listens to the show is not a believer in the God that we believe, and that's okay, because everybody has a choice, and God gives us a choice. But, honey, I know for me personally, and even to you and to watch you, even you coming on now, because we're right at almost a year of Tyquan being gone, even for you to be able to speak this is nothing but God's grace and mercy for you to have the strength to be able to come on and share this. Because you have always been a voice for somebody else. I mean, the one thing that I've always loved about you, even in meeting you, it's always about somebody else. You're always out in the forefront to bring about change to our communities and acceptance of each other as individuals. And so this, of course, is part of the purpose of us bringing those children into our life that we now no longer have, is to say, what can I do with their lives when they're here? How can I impact things in them so that they are good to the community and bringing grace and glory to the Creator? And then what can I do now that they are no longer here to still do that, right? And so for you to be able to have this voice about mental illness, it's huge, because especially in our community, we refuse it, and that's because of the taboo that has been for so long. We cannot be mentally ill, one, because we're black. Black people don't get mentally ill. That's what we're told. In case any of you are listening, you don't know, especially if you're not coming from a black or Latino community, black people don't have mental illness. That's a white mental illness. That's something white people have. That's a myth. Mm-hmm. The other thing we say is, well, you know, you just take it to God and you just pray about it and it goes away. That's also a part truth, part myth. And the reason I say that is, it's because if we are under the Christian influence and belief, even Jesus called the doctor into the 12 disciples. So if Jesus called Luke the physician, obviously he knew we needed to be taken care of in a physical way, that our bodies and our minds had to be cared for. So I always try to point people back to, don't you think if it was nothing that was ever going to be needed to be done by a physician, God would have never called him one as a disciple? But that's just my belief. So we have to take care of the mind, the body, and the soul. Being a black person, being a Christian, we still have to take care of all of the things in us that need to be made whole. That includes prayer with faith, with action. But here is the thing. If you have to take medications, this is where the advocacy comes. What are these medications, and how can they be used together or not? How much needs to be taken? You know, so it's a working with doctors that really, truly care. I was very fortunate in my journey and still on my journey to find doctors. And it took 7 years to find a really good therapist that worked with me, walked with me through medication. We talked about it. I kept a journal. This is not working. My wife would say, she's not taking that, because in the middle of the day, she's telling Hitler. This is things that I was doing on medication. Out of nowhere, I want to take rat poison. Out of nowhere, I want to commit suicide. Out of nowhere, because the medications were not things that were working with my body. And so it's imperative that you do what you're doing, and that's the advocacy for, you know, the proper medications, if that, and or working with holistic medication. You know, we've come a long way in how physicians are taking care of us, and it's our responsibility as parents or the patient to make sure that we're taken care of properly.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
So we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back, finish this conversation with Ms. Tracy Wilson.
You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network.
Sonny and Jazzy of Loudmouth TV is taking off with a brand new show, Off the Market, with its first season within the beautiful state of Hawaii, featuring some of the most sought-after areas of beachfront and inner island properties on the island of Maui and Oahu. Tune in to each episode with host Jazzy Jones-Smith as she talks to feature real estate agents as they showcase their open house listings to private homeowner tours where you just might find a house that you may want to take off the market.
Hello, I'm Denise Kennedy, owner of Shirley Girl Boutique. My brand is plus size women fashion, sizes 1X to 3X, specializing in plus size maxis and jumpsuits. I also offer African-inspired pieces, one size fit most. My ideal clients are beautiful plus size and curvy women who looks like me and who has embraced their curves and loves what she wears. My goal as an image consultant is to provide style and fashion to complement those beautiful curves. If you're looking for plus-size maxis, jumpsuits, African pieces, please be so kind to visit my website at shirleygirlboutique.com. Please like and follow me on Facebook and Instagram at Shirley Girl Boutique, or you can give me a call at 800-294-5497. We're open Monday through Saturday from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. You can also browse and shop 24/7 at Shirley Girl Boutique. Before I leave, I want to say thank you, and to let you know that plus size is not a curse, it's an extra dose of loving.
You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Loudmouth Radio Network. You're listening to The Bare Truth, Love, Life, Sex, and Flowers with me, Jazzy Jones-Smith. I'm so excited to have Tracy Wilson of the TNT Foundation here talking with us today about lost love and really healing conversations about mental illness and wellness for that matter. So, Tracy, we were talking about medications and how important it is. What have you seen during this journey as far as change when it comes down to how physicians, or have you seen it yet? Have you been able to talk to any of the physicians that were a part of your son's treatment about how to change this serious issue, actually, of being misdiagnosed and overdiagnosed with improper medications?
To be honest, I haven't seen any change in the mental health industry here in Georgia. And to be brutally honest, the doctors, his doctors won't even talk to me at the mental hospital Advantage in Athens. They won't even address the situation with me. It's been an ongoing battle. It even so much as the train company, I never got like a formal apology. I never got I'm condolence, I'm sorry, was the company on behalf of the company. I never got any of that from CSX train company or anybody from Advanced Mental Health Hospital in Athens. I haven't received any. And, you know, we ask questions. You know, we wanted his medical records. It took them 2 months just to release his medical records to me. I had to go through hoops and battles just to prove that I was his mother. I mean, some of the laws have changed that you got to go through the court to be the. It was a mess, and so they didn't release his medical records to me right away. And but I'm reaching out to some people. Like, I want to reach out to Jennifer Lewis, who is bipolar, and I want to reach out to Taraji Henson because her father was diagnosed. So, you know, I want to talk to some people, and you know, of course, talk to you and just, you know, because it's serious. It's really, really within 4 days. Like, he was admitted to the hospital on the 8th. They released him on the 12th, and then he died on the 16th. So there was no confidence to be sure that his medicine was, you know, adjusted. It was the right type of medicine. None of that. I'm just like, it's a lot of medicine to have one person at one time, you know. I'm one of those. The mama bear has come out now, you know, and I want to sit down and have a conversation with some heavy hitters down here in Georgia first, you know, to start here because it's the home base of the foundation, and just get some answers. You know, I've reached out to some of the facilities here, so I'm just waiting on a call back. Waiting on, it's not. I don't even want to call back. I may just go in their face, you know, ask some questions.
Exactly. Hey, I'm here.
Right. In a very professional way.
But you know what? If we look at our counterparts that are not of the African American culture, don't they do the same? Don't they fight to the tooth, to the death? Don't they rally to the death almost for their children or for something that they feel like, listen, we need to acknowledge this. We need to change this. A lot of times in our community, we don't. Or if we do, we get tired of the battle because it is a battle when it's something that has not been one way and we have to go in and change it. People are not always easy and receptive to that change, and especially if we're saying you were wrong or you need to be corrected and something needs to be fixed. So, yeah, sometimes you do have to just kind of walk up to the door and go, hi, my name is, and I'm, you know, I've been calling, I've been emailing, I've been texting, but now I'm here. And so you have to face me. You have to see me because a lot of times, Tracy, the names are forgotten. We have this thing that has gone worldwide that I say her name, I say his name. And it's important that we say our names and say their names or our just causes have a name because people will make it a thing. It will be, oh, it's on the table. What
it on the table. The law is on the table. Well, what is the law? The law has a name because something happened that we needed to change the law or we needed to change the rule. And so the rule comes with a name behind it. So, yeah, you're doing the right thing. You're on the right path, and I'm so glad that you've taken the time to heal thyself first and just a continual healing process so that you will be strong enough to be able to stand up and roar, you know, and be that bear for your children, because now you're not only the voice of the children that have gone, but you're the voice of the children and the adults, for that matter, that are coming along that need to know that somebody's in their corner. That needs to know that, you know what, I've gone through that as well. And because I've gone through that as well, I'm here to support you. But I'm also glad that you're saying something that I didn't have the strength to say. So clapping for you continually. So where would you like us to help you? How would you like the community and this radio network, for that matter, how would you like us to be in your corner? Because a lot of times, when you say, I need help, sometimes we're not specific in how that help comes. So what would you like community, friends, network, and all of the people you're reaching out, what would you like us to do?
Ooh.
That's a big one, right?
That's a big question. Well, first and foremost, having discussions like this, the importance of knowing. And like you said, putting a name to it, you know, it was real hard for me to say verbally Tyquan was diagnosed with bipolar because of the myth that that's not a black thing. That's, you know what I'm saying? That because of that myth, it was very difficult for me to say that. And in order for me to live in my truth, I have to be brutally honest with what's going on. Because how can I heal someone else if I telling the absolute truth about what really happened with my son. You know what I mean? So your question, I'm still, you know, things like this, having old round table discussions face to face. I'm actually stepping out on things and doing a 5-part live series starting next Saturday on the 5 stages of life, you know, starting with denial, you know, going through, because a lot of people are in those things and they don't want to talk about it. And some people in our community, and not just in our community, are going through it alone, and they don't have to go through it alone. You know? So it was given to me as a vision. You need to go live so people can see you. They can see your face. They can see the rawness. Mm-hmm. They can see there's no filters. The real, you know, the raw truth about it. So I'm starting that segment next Saturday at 7 live on Facebook.
Excellent.
And hopefully that reaches someone, you know, just a message, because the 5 stages of grief are real. Denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And like I told you in the beginning, I'm just at the place of acceptance. You know, just getting there. Like, whew, I made it. You know, I made it. And then I got to start all that over again. And this time it's twice the sadness, because not only do I have to, because I don't get a break. Terrell was born in February. Tyquan passed away in April. Tyquan was born in June. Terrell passed away in September. So I don't really get a break from grieving. You know what I mean? So I have to find little glimpses of hope. And one thing about my children that I know without a shadow of a doubt, that they would want me to be happy. They would want me to live.
Yes. Yeah.
Not sad.
Yeah.
And I'm still thinking on your question, but I'm saying we could do roundtable discussions. We can, the thing that I'm really working on is actually getting the bill passed here in Georgia, and it's going to be called Tyquan's Law. And that's basically when a child or a young adult is injured in the hospital, that they get a mandatory stay for at least 7 days. So that this medication can work in their system, that the parents feel comfortable enough that their children are okay to have them released from the hospital. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it makes complete sense. It makes complete sense.
So, you know,
now, we do have some people on air right now. I just want to let you know that we appreciate you listening. If it is something that you want to add to the conversation respectfully, understand respectfully,
because we have had some people on air that were not so respectful. But respectfully, if you would like to be a part of the conversation, please hit your number one on your dial. We do have some people online. If you have a question or a comment, you are able to type that in and we can present it to our guest. And hopefully we can answer it in the best way possible. I do want to disclose that we are not doctors. We are people who have experienced a lot. We've gone through a lot individually as a radio network and individually as parents. So we're not doctors, but we are able to speak our truth in the best way possible. So if it's at any moment you feel like you need an answer from a doctor, please reach out to your healthcare providers or contact. We will have the 1-800 suicide and mental illness. NAMI is one of the people who we do work with. I work with them for many, many years, so we will have some information for you on our social media, but we will also provide that in this segment. So if you do want to talk, please hit the number one. If you just want to continue to listen, hit two or just stay where you are in queue. But I do want to give you some statistics. Just a little bit of information about the reluctance and the inability to access mental health care services. So approximately 30% of African-American adults with mental illness receive treatment each year, 30% out of 100, compared to the U.S. average of 43%. And the reason why is some of the things that we talked about, but here are a few others. Distrust and misdiagnosis, not wanting to believe that I have bipolar disorder or your son has bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, or anything with depression. Historically, African Americans have been and continue to be negatively affected by prejudice and discrimination in the healthcare system. Misdiagnosis, inadequate treatment, and the lack of cultural competence by health professionals cause distrust and prevent many of us from seeking or staying in treatment. And then we also have the socioeconomic factors that play a part, which can make treatment options less available. If we can't afford the medication or the proper medication, then we can't take it. If we cannot afford holistic treatment, you know, it's been a big evidence that has been shown in mental health care that cannabinoids, the CBD oils, have helped people with mental illness. But how have we fought long and hard for it to become legal in every state? And so now we have hemp oils becoming legal, but then there are times when we need higher doses of THC that has not yet been federally approved all over. So holistically, can we afford to take care of ourselves with proper diet and health? If you go into the grocery stores now, if you look on the majority side of the grocery store that we in the African-American community and brown skin people can afford is all sugar, sugar, and more sugar. So it's not proper diet that we have. So it's so many things that can cause us not to be our best and whole selves, even mentally. So it's a lot of things here, and I'll provide this information for you that keep us from being able to be treated in our communities. But the lack of trust with the healthcare provider and then the spiritual side of our conversation is, like I said before, let's just pray about it. So, no, we're not going to believe things when we've been taught our entire life that those things are wrong and those things don't happen to us. We're not going to accept a diagnosis. I didn't accept my diagnosis. Are you kidding me? I'm over the Women's Empowerment Ministry. I'm doing outreach. I'm doing all these things. What do you mean I have a mental illness? Are you insane? This is crazy. I'm just tired. I'm just this. But when you find yourself crying and crouching down at a register with the register drawer wide open because you can't even get up and speak to somebody that you just smiled at like 3 seconds ago and all of a sudden you couldn't take the rest of the things that are going on in your head and your mind because you just too depressed, you're just overwhelmed. That's not just being tired. That's a problem. That's a mental problem. And guess what? It's okay. And just as if I was watching somebody seconds ago and all of a sudden I went immediately blind, nobody would have a problem with that. They would say, oh my God, we don't know what happened, but she just went blind. She's so sweet. It wouldn't be a problem.
But because when we say mental illness, now all of a sudden it's a problem. Now all of a sudden it's taboo. Now all of a sudden we shouldn't have that. So we have to, as Jennifer Lewis says, we have to have this as a situation where it's just as common as talking about any other illness, because that's the only way that we're going to be healed. So, you know, you're doing the right thing by, one, starting the conversation of understanding, two, putting it out there for other people to say, hey, if you're not afraid to talk about it, I'm not afraid to talk about it. And not being afraid to talk about it is facing it and rising versus facing it and running. Because the longer we run away from it, the longer we will be in the position where we're not adequately taken care of. You know? Right. Did you want to say something, producer? Wait a minute, producer. Don't try to come on and sound like this, y'all. We all hear this. It's really going to be her.
Producer,
this
is right before sundown. Yes.
Can you hear her? Hold on. Producer's trying to speak. Hold on.
Hear her, but yeah.
Go ahead, Tracy. Go ahead.
Hey, son.
Hey, sweetie. I got something for you.
Hi.
Hey. She got something.
No, you're saying something. Go ahead and try. I told y'all she wasn't gonna stay silent. I told you. I told y'all she was not gonna be able to be on this thing listening and not speak. Go ahead and try. Everybody's waiting. Anticipating.
Okay, Tracy, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. I just felt this on my heart to share this with you. I've been listening and working the switchboard. I wanna leave this to you, okay?
Okay.
Okay.
And she put in some mood music to try to fill in the cracks of her voice. Her raspy voice. Oh my God. I wish I was videoing this so everybody could watch this drama. Nobody's even going to hear you with all of that song music in the back, honey.
Okay. I'll turn it down.
I can video you and I can read it and you can do a whole dance and ballet.
Okay. This is for you, Tracy.
Okay.
Everywhere I'm turning, and then Jazzy will be dropping the phone. Everywhere I'm turning, nothing seems complete. I stand up and I'm searching for the better part of me. I hang my head from sorrow and state of humanity. I wear it on my shoulders, gotta find the strength in me. I am a superwoman, yes I am. Yes, she is. Even when I'm a man, I still put on the best. With an S on my chest. Oh, yes, I'm a superwoman. For all the mothers, I am Tracy and others, fighting for better days to come. And all my women sitting here trying to come home before the sun, and all my sisters coming together. Say yes, I will. Yes, you can. Because you, Tracy, are a superwoman.
Oh, sweet. Thank you, sweet.
Now, I was good. Here go the tears. Man.
She had to do
it.
She had to do it. That was so beautiful, Sonny. But you are a superwoman, Tracy. God has given you supernatural strength that so many of us would never have had. And only you, we're not even talking about fairness. This is not about what's fair. But only you could have handled this. Only you could have handled this. And that's why you are handling this. So it's such a beautiful, absolutely incredible space for you to be in, because you can handle this. For all of us that need change in these areas, you can do this.
It's true.
I love it. Sonny, you got me in tears over here. Oh my God.
I know, right? I know. She's gonna have to. I love you more. You're gonna have to send that to me. Put it on my page or something. Oh my God, that was beautiful. See, I was
well, those are beautiful lyrics of Alicia Keys. Those are Alicia Keys' lyrics of her song, Superwoman.
And she put
it. And I just added it to the equation. So I just recently found out that when Alicia wrote that song, it was for her grandmother who was dying.
Oh,
I didn't know that either. Yeah. But I found out I'm ready to talk.
Oh.
Love you, Tracy.
I love you guys.
Thank you
for having me on your show.
Tracy, in closing, what would you like our audience to know? Where can they find you? I know you said step two, it's coming up on your live feed that you will be doing this weekend, but just let everybody know how they can find you and just how to follow you.
Well, I am on Facebook, Tracy Wilson. Facebook group is the TNT Wilson Foundation. The website is under construction because of the name changes and everything like that. So we have to redo the website. So I am on Facebook. I am on Twitter. I am Miss Diva 2K on Twitter and Jersey Doll on Instagram. But I'm mainly on Facebook. Like I said, the name of the Facebook group is the TNT Wilson Foundation. Coming up March 14th, I'm doing a 5-part series on the 5 stages of grief. My book is scheduled to be released. My third book, actually, is scheduled to be released April 16th, and it's called When Pain Meets Power. So I'm super excited about that. We may have to push the date back a little bit because I'm working on the cover. You know how we are.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Yes.
But the release date is tentatively April 16th, and it's called When Pain Meets Power. And of course, if your friends with Jazzy or Sunny, that's probably an easier way because they can find me and you guys.
That's right. When you put it in, your name is gonna pop up on Loud Mouth Radio more than once. Again, Tracy's book will be out, and I'm gonna be safe to say 2020. That way, we'll be safe to say whenever it comes out, we are in line to get it. She may be posting very soon. Pre-orders for you to be able to get the book, and I'm sure she'll be able to sign those pre-orders for you. Listen, I'm plugging that in for her. So, guys, let's support her. We're going to do some pre-orders, honey. You need to tell them how much the book is going to be, and they can go ahead and cash app you right now. I'm putting that out on Loud Mouth Radio, that the pre-orders of the book From Pain to...
No, it's When Pain Meets Power. Like
When Pain Meets Power. Yes, When Pain Meets Power by Tracy Wilson. Sharing her story. Pre-orders starting as soon as she gets off of this radio show. She's going to tell you how much it's going to be. She's going to post it on the website. And we are going to support her. Website and Facebook. I know website is under construction. So Facebook, she's going to tell you exactly how much the pre-orders are going to be. Because you know what, guys? We're here to support each other. And the reason why we fail is because we don't get the support of the very people who said, girl, let me know. So we're letting you know, Loud Mouth Radio Network, the pre-order for the book is going to be available. You can cash out. If she ain't got Venmo, she's going to get it. She's going to get Zelle. She's going to get anything y'all need so y'all can help support this new book coming up, and I know it's going to be powerful. I already know, because you can only share a little bit on radio. You can only share a little bit, but when you have to give the detail of the detail to the detail, it's got to be in the book. So we're excited about that for you. Tracy, you know we're so excited about all the good things that are happening in your life. We're definitely going to follow you. We're definitely going to plug you and support you 100%. In anything that you do, because everything you do is phenomenal. It's just phenomenal. So we're sending hugs all the way from California now. Well, we're back in Georgia, which will be very soon. Tracy, let me ask you a question. I know that we had the magnificent CPR class that From Words to Action, our outreach ministry, was able to be a part of a couple of years ago. So I do know that you still are a part of pushing heart health. So I don't want to leave before we make sure that, you know, if it's anything that you're doing with that, to plug that before we get off.
Yes, I am still a CPR instructor. So when you guys come back to Georgia to have your class again, I'm teamed up with Children's Healthcare of Atlanta. And if you go through my organization, the Tracy Wilson Foundation, the CPR classes are actually free. So now that you put that out there, I have to set up a class.
Yes, and girl.
To be CPR
I'm going to be right there with the mannequin again. Come on. Defibrillator.
I still have pictures of you with the mannequin. But if they go through the foundation, because the CPR class is not free, but if they go through the organization, I offer it for free. So
okay.
Now that you put the there, I will definitely put a class together. As a matter of fact, I'm due to call the president tomorrow anyway. So we'll be putting that together shortly so that we can open up that CPR training to the public. And I will put
they can find that on the Facebook page, right?
TNC Wilson Foundation.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Well, I always like to plug things that you're doing because, you know, when we have this shot, when we get off radio, we're like, dang, I should have said this, I should have said that. So wanted to make sure that people can follow the things that you do. Once again, everybody, please follow her on the Facebook page while the website is being revamped with the new name change logo and all of those kind of things from Terrell Wilson Foundation to the TNT Wilson Foundation, right? On Facebook,
yes.
And then that way you can go ahead and buy the book, pre-order. You can sign up for the CPR class. You can follow her for the grief.
For the what?
Coughing. Sonny is coughing, so she needs to, like, run out of the studio. I'm so sorry for her. But nevertheless, you'll be able to follow her on the live feed for the five stages of grief and just get in touch with her on any of the things. If you want her to be able to come and talk about her experiences with her son, she is available for paid speaking engagements, and she's able to travel all over the world because that's what she does. She wants to reach out and make sure that this information is given to everybody. So you'll be able to get all of that information. Tracy, we love you, Mama.
I love you, too.
Thank you so much. Look, she's in bed. She's run out while she's coughing and hacking. And this is all from allergies, so I don't want anybody calling me saying, oh, my God, what does she have? And this is from allergies. These trees and all of this dust in California is something. When you see the old westerns and all of the stuff flowing and blowing all over the place, it's true in the part of California we're in, so. That's it's allergies. We don't have the corona over here, unless it's a beer.
Three jobs.
Oh my goodness!
So anyway, love you too, baby. Take care.
Take care.
You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network.
Thank you, everybody, for being a part of this listening experience on Loudmouth Radio Network. We really do appreciate you for taking out just a small time of the day to hear the topics that we bring to you. Hopefully, we are doing exactly what our mission statement says, and that's we're here to empower, inspire, and to entertain. And definitely, Tracy Wilson and TNT Wilson Foundation is an inspiration and empowers us all to, you know, love our families a little bit more and be involved in their lives in ways that might not always be comfortable but always unnecessary. And then definitely to inspire the community to change in areas of ways that need to be changed. You know, everything is not right just because it was invented one way. Some things do need to be changed when they're not working. And so hopefully this conversation today has impacted you to make a change for mental health. Stand up, rally, that this conversation is a normal conversation. It's a conversation that needs to be had in every home. How are you feeling today is not always about how is your body feeling, but how is your mind? How is your heart? You know, how are you doing? And if you are not doing well, be brave enough to say, I am not doing well and I need help. Because a lot of times we do. And we're afraid to reach out to get that help because of how people
prejudge us when we do. So it's okay. If you're having some issues, please, please, please turn to people that you feel like will support you in the decision to get the help that you need from maybe a medical care profession or a therapist or just wherever you find yourself in need of. And if you cannot or you don't feel like you can get the help, we're going to give you the 1-800 number for the hotline for mental illness. It's important. It's important to have people who will listen to you, even if those people are not right in your circle. So I know Producer Sunny is getting that number for us now, for NAMI, for Suicide Hotline, because it's important that we have that for you. And we will post those as well, like I said earlier, on our Facebook pages and on our social media. We will also have that on Loudmouth Radio. Our organization for Works in Action Outreach Ministries also work with people with mental illness, with mental challenges, because it's always important for us to be able to support the people in the community. So if you are in a position of feeling despondent, depressed, and you are not feeling like you want to stay with us, stay with us. Trust me, I've been there, I know, and I understand. That number for you to have support, if you can't find support right in your own circle, is 1-800-273-8255. And maybe you are not actually going to act out on it, but maybe you're feeling like it, and they're able to walk you through it, talk you through it, and get you to the place that you need. Don't be afraid to go in the hospital. Now, I know all hospitals are not created equal, but sometimes if that's the step we have to take, that's the step we have to take. When you're getting medications, ask all of the questions that you possibly can. What is this medication going to do? Is this medication able to be mixed with another medication? I'm already taking this, or, you know, I'm on blood pressure medication, or whatever it is. Make sure that those healthcare professions are working for you individually and not collectively, because everybody that takes one thing doesn't mean that I can take it. So as much as you can in the state that you are, work for you, love you, care for you, and make sure that you are the best you can be in that moment. And it gets better. You know, when we have a burn, that burn is painful. Or when we take a fall, that fall is painful. And until we get to a place of strength, you know, it takes a minute to heal, but we heal. And so it's the same with mental illness. Sometimes we're in a place that we can't handle anything, and so we need things to help us to handle. So as you get stronger, you may not need as much medication, or you might not need that medication, or you may change along the way, but stay with it, stick with it. Everything is going to be okay. And for the parents and for the family and supporters, get your own therapy. It is a different type of therapy. Person who's sick or ill, they don't go through this by themselves. You go through it with them. And so whatever you need to do to become the best you for yourself and for your family member, do that. I encourage you to do that. I'm loving you. I'm hugging you and knowing that everything's going to be okay. We appreciate you again for listening to Loud Mouth Radio. Again, if you would like to be a part of this platform, 706-363-3895 for any commercial or business representation. We'd be glad to talk to you, and we will see you on the next show.
You're listening to the Loudmouth Radio Network.
When I was diagnosed with cancer, it felt like my whole world came tumbling down.
Patient Advocate Foundation is here for you, providing free one-on-one practical support to patients with a cancer diagnosis. Call us at 800-532-5274. Patient Advocate Foundation can assist in navigating disability benefits and health insurance options. PAF also helps in accessing vital services, medications, and financial resources for both medical and household expenses. Visit patientadvocate.org or call 800-532-5274.